I'm in. Okay, share the screen. All right. Shall we bow for prayer? Father God, thank you for this day that even though Perth is on lockdown, we can still gather in church via technology, Lord. God, we just want to remember all those who are having it rough, who are caught off guard by this lockdown. Father God, will you provide for them? Lord, you see them, you hear them, Lord, and will you take care of them? We want to pray especially for any of our members as well who might be needing masks or food supplies as well. Lord, will you bring food supplies for them as well? Father, we want to pray for this service, even though it's online. Father, Lord, that we will experience your closeness and your presence wherever we are, Lord, in our homes. Help us to be fruitful, Lord, even in our time at home during this lockdown. And Lord, we pray that you will bring us back safely together once again when this whole episode is over. We commit this whole time to you, and we pray that you anoint Pastor Jacob's lips as he proclaims the word for us later as well. And we will continue praying the Lord's Prayer now. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. You may be seated if you're not already seated. Now the scripture reading for today is taken from 1 Samuel 8, 1 to 22. Can I invite everybody to read together with your mics muted, of course, increase participation, right? All right. Israel asked for a king. When Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons as Israel's leaders. The name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second was Abijah, and they served at Beersheba. But his sons did not follow his ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain and accepted bribes and perverted justice. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king, as they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods. So they are doing to you. Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will claim as his rights." Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking him for a king. He said, "This is what the king who will reign over you will claim as his rights. He will take your sons and make them serve with his chariots and horses, and they will run in front of his chariots. Some he will assign to be commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and others to plow his ground and reap his harvest, and still others to make weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive groves and give them to his attendants. He will take a tenth of your grain and of your vintage and give it to his officials and attendants. Your male and female servants and the best of your cattle and donkeys he will take for his own use. He will take a tenth of your flocks and you yourselves will become his slaves. When that day comes, you will cry out for relief from the king you have chosen. But the Lord will not answer you in that day." But the people refused to listen to Samuel. "No," they said, "we want a king over us. Then we will be like all the other nations, with a king to lead us and go out before us and fight our battles." When Samuel heard all that the people said, he repeated it before the Lord. The Lord answered, "Listen to them and give them a king." Then Samuel said to the Israelites, "Everyone go back to your own town." Okay, thus ends the reading of God's word. We will now invite Pastor Jacob Law. I think at the beginning I said local preacher. He's no longer a local preacher. He's a fully fledged pastor in Grace Methodist Church now. And he will be preaching via the IMC window as one of our participants. So please make his screen full screen. Pastor Jacob, over to you.
Thank you, Pastor Ivan. I believe through the share screen, you would already see me on the left-hand side of your screen and the share screen, the PowerPoint at the right-hand side. I think you should be able to see that. What do you want? What do you want? What do we want? When I walk up to the pulpit, I want to undo my mask so that I can speak, so I can sing, so that I can breathe freely and normally. Brothers and sisters, this morning, let's think about what do you want? This is a direct quotation from our Lord Jesus Christ according to the Gospel of John. When Jesus saw there's the two disciples following him for the first time, he turned around and he asked these two disciples, "What do you want?" It's a savage question, isn't it? Pretty savage. Because no one wants to be confronted with a question like, "What do you want?" It is a confronting message. It is a confronting passage. But you know what? This is exactly what the Lord God wants to ask about. This is exactly what the Lord God wants us to think through this passage. What do we want? So before we start this morning's message, let's commit our time in prayer. Dear Lord, you used to speak to Samuel. So Lord, we ask you to speak to us today and with the Holy Spirit to set our hearts right. And we pray in your name. Amen. Before knowing what do we want, before knowing where do we come from, we need to recount the history. And the verse 1 to verse 4 from what we've read this morning help us to recount the history. And what did the history tell us? The history tells us that Samuel, he grew old, and Israel need a new leader. Israel need to come to the new stage of life. They need to go into the new stage of history. This is what happens to Israel. So when we recount the history, we see that for fact that Samuel indeed, he was old. He used to be a fierce, strong, powerful leader who inspires the fear of the enemy and inspires the loyalty of God's people. But Samuel, he grew old. When Samuel was old, something that is more troubling, something that is more concerning happens. That is his sons, both of his sons, Joab and Abijah, they are unworthy leader. They are unworthy leader of Israel. They are unworthy and unfaithful people in front of God. The pattern that we observe through this passage is pretty similar to the pattern that we observe from the previous book of this in the Bible, the book of Judges. If you remember in the book of Judges, you would see that there are a lot of judges, and in that book, it described a pattern, what we called a downward spiral pattern. Spiral is something that turning round and round and round. Okay, so the life of the judges or the life of Israel in the time of the judges is turning round and round and round. People sin and then God passed his judgment and then people cry out for deliverance and then they were delivered and then they live in peace and then they fall into sin again. And every time this pattern repeats itself, it gets worse and worse. So people call it the downward spiral pattern. And when we see Samuel and his sons, we see this same pattern continues from the book of Judges into the book of Samuel. And it happens to Samuel. there's a very famous quotation in the book of Judges that we always see. It reads like this. In those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as they saw fit. Yes, everyone did as they saw fit because there's no king. And every enemy of the people did as they saw fit because Israel had no king. So naturally, in those days, people were missing those days of Joshua, for example, because in the days of Joshua, Israel was a strong nation. In the days of Joshua, Israel was triumphant. They enter into Canaan and they chase away those who live in Canaan. In the days of Joshua, God's promise to Israel, to Abraham, carried out and come into fruition. It was fulfilled in the days of Joshua under the leadership of Joshua. And of course, the Israel people, they can recount their history. And when they recount their history, they saw the days of Moses. In the days of Moses, the mighty Pharaoh and all his power, all his chariots, all his army was laid waste. In the day of Moses, the people of God were delivered from the most powerful grip of a most powerful king, Pharaoh. In those days, brothers and sisters, we always think about our life in the terms of in those days. In those days, we don't need to wear a mask. In those days where our church is prosperous and all our ministry is booming. In those days where Perth economy is so good, everyone has business and no one left without a job, without a high-paying job. In those days. But when the people of Israel recounted the history, what did they do? We see again from verse 5 to verse 9, people making a request. Verse 5, those people making a request. They assemble together to meet the prophet Samuel, that is the leader in their day. And they want to meet Samuel and they want to make a request to this prophet Samuel. And let's have a look at people's request. Let's look at what people is asking for in the time of pressure, in the time of stress. According to verse 4 says, so all the elders of Israel gathered together, all of them, all the elders, all the leaders, all the fathers of different houses and tribes, they gather together. When we see the language of gather together, we think of the holy assembly of God. Because God's people will gather together as an assembly a few times in a year to observe the holy days, to pay their tributes to God, to worship their Lord God. But here we see that in the passage, when these people, all the elders of Israel, gathered together, they were doing and they were about to do something that is terribly unholy, something that is very concerning, because they want to do something such as all the other nations have. They want to make a demand, they want to make a request to the Lord their God to be like the other nations. Brothers and sisters, do you know what that means? That means God's people, they wanted to live like those people without God. I repeat it again. The request, the nature of their request is as God's people, they want to live like those people without God. And in regards to this, we see that in the passage. What is God's response? God's response is God told Samuel directly in regards to people's request. Is that you listen to what they say, and here is what they are really saying. They're seemingly rejecting you, Samuel, as their leader. And they're rejecting, of course, you and your sons to be their leader. But they are actually rejecting me, the Lord God, who used to deliver them as their king. This is what we see in verse 7. God determined that the people are actually rejecting him as their leader, as their king. And immediately in verse 8, we see that God brings this kind of rejection in connection to their history of rejecting God. Verse 8 says that they rejected God in the wilderness by rejecting God's servant Moses. So the people used to reject Moses in the wilderness. And also in verse 8, we see that they also rejected Joshua in the time of Joshua, in a gesture that they are rejecting God, because both Moses and Joshua, they were the servants of God. And what does that mean? That means the people turn away. They turn away from the people who lead them to serve God, lead them to submit to God. They turn away from this and turn to those nations to serve other gods. And they did this in the land where God has given them. You know, when God spoke those words to Samuel, God spoke as a judge. God spoke as a judge. God is passing a judgment. And who is this God to pass a judgment? This God is the sovereign God. This God is the all-knowing God. This God is the God who knows all men's heart. This God, he knows everything. He do not need to have evidence, because he himself is both the evidence and the witness. This God received the case that brought up by Samuel, and he passed the judgment. And brothers and sisters, I want you to observe from verse 9, what is God's judgment? God said, "Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly and let them know." So this is God's judgment. This is God's judgment. Isn't that strange to you, brothers and sisters? Have you seen a judge in a real world? After receiving the case and presiding the case, after hearing all the evidence that pointing to the accused, that this accused are so convicted, this accused have no excuse for to escape for what he was accused of. And yet, after this judge passing the judgment, passing the conviction, the verdict, then he's giving out his sentence. And when the sentence is spoken, the sentence is what? The sentence is warning. The sentence is his word. God gave his very word as the sentence to the rebellious people. And indeed, brothers and sisters, I want you to observe, I want you to see that this God, who he is. He is the God slow to anger, merciful and abounding in steadfast love. This God, who is a God who give his warning, who give his word. His word means he is slow to anger. His word means he is slow to pass out the judgment. His word also means that it is a warning word, that there is something terrible, something very decisive, something very bad is going to come if they do not heed their word, if they do not listen to him. And God's warning is about the king that people are asked for. God's warning is about the cost when these people are asking for a king. God's warning is about what is going to cost us if we ask and if we follow by the direction of our desire and by the desire of our hearts. This is God's warning. So let's look again. Let's continue to look at the Bible from verse 10 to verse 18 about what is the cost that is going to cost people when they're asking from God. So what is the cost for Israel to have a king? What is the cost? The cost is, firstly, that king will be a human king. This king, he have to live like a human. He come with a human desire. He come with a human vanity. He come with a human demand. And this king, he will demand a lot and a lot from you. This is what the passage said. the passage from verse 10 to verse 18. We can read it as if Prophet Samuel, he is delivering a message. Certainly, Prophet Samuel, he is very, very, very eloquent. And his message inspires imagination, inspires people who were led by their own fantasy and their own way, inspire them and put them back into reality to think clearly and to think critically about what they are asking. And here's what people are asking for. This king, he is a willful king. This king, he is going to do a lot of things. Brothers and sisters, count in your Bible from verse 11 to verse 17. How many times in Samuel's sermon, this king, he will do something? How many times in the Bible says he will? We counted in from verse 11 to verse 17. There are seven times in this short message that this king, he will take something from the people. And in verse 18, we see that he will end it like this. Verse 18 read, "He will, when that day come, you will cry out for relief from the king you have chosen. But the Lord will not answer you in that day." This is the end of Prophet Samuel's sermon. Pretty grim, isn't it? No one wants to hear a message like that. But that's exactly the message Samuel delivered as instructed by the Lord. Samuel delivered the message. Samuel says, "You will cry out for relief from the things that you ask for." Where else in the Bible did the Israelites cry out to the Lord? Where else in the Bible people cry out to God? Where else did it happen? Didn't they cry out to the Lord in the book of Judges? People of Israel cry out to the Lord in the book of Judges when they were oppressed by the nations. Is it not? And didn't the people of Israel cry out to the Lord in the book of Exodus when they were oppressed by another foreign king, Pharaoh? Didn't that just happen right in front of their eyes not too long ago? And yet, Prophet Samuel tells them that you will cry out again for this time because you have chosen a destiny, you have chosen a way you want to go, and you have rejecting the Lord by choosing what you want. Brothers and sisters, all of the above, all of the examples that we see in the book of Judges and in the book of Exodus and in the book of Samuel, all of this, God hear people's cry and God answering their cry by delivering them. But now what? Now what? We see that from verse 19 to verse 22, that the people that did something in response to Samuel's sermon, in response to Samuel's message. And what did the people do and what did the people say? Let's look at it together. Verse 19. But the people refused to listen to Samuel and they say, "No." So it's very firm, one word, decisive, "No," from the mouth and from the heart of the people. These people, they want to be someone else. And they want to be like someone else. They look at someone else, someone who have a good life, someone who seemingly have a better country, someone who seems to have a better leadership. They seems to be a better people. And they look at them and they said, "Aha, that is what I want to be like. That is what I want." This is the decision of the people, like the nations. They want to be like the nations. But what did the Lord do and what did the Lord said? We see that in verse 22, after Samuel delivering people's word to the Lord said, "Listen to them and give them and the king." And then Samuel returned and he told the Israelites who make this demand to go back. This is basically to say, wait and see, wait and see. And indeed, see what? What is expecting? What is waiting for them? You know, there is a story. Many people from China heard of this story because it comes with a story that's an idiom. The story tells about a long time ago, there was a man. His name is Mr. Yep. Okay, Mr. Yep. So this Mr. Yep, he has a very, very interesting or peculiar kind of hobby or interest. He liked the dragon, you know, a mysterious creature. He loved the dragon, he likes the dragon. So Mr. Yep, he became so famous in his nation for being such a dragon lover. He loved dragons so much so that he think about the dragon all the time. He think about this mystical creature all the time, this mighty dragon fly in the sky, you know, that no man can see, but somehow he just fly. Without a wing, this dragon can fly. And this dragon is the symbol of power. This dragon is symbol of something mystical, something that is so transcendent, something that is so great. And this Mr. Yep, he loved dragon, and he dreamed about dragon, he think about dragon, and he even talked to this mystical dragon. He want to see him. He want to somehow have an encounter with the dragon. And after living a life like that for some time, and after asking and requesting over and over again, so fiercely for his whole life, finally, the mystical dragon king decided to grant him the opportunity of meeting him. So one day, when Mr. Yep doing his usual praising and asking the dragon king to show himself, the dragon king suddenly appears in his room. And by the look of this huge, big, terrifying, giant teeth, imagine that suddenly, while you're sitting in your room, Godzilla stick his head into your window and say, "I," and what would that be? And what would you feel? Okay, imagine that. And that's exactly what happens to Mr. Yep. And Mr. Yep was terrified. He had a heart attack, and then he died. So this is a famous. It's called Mr. Yep's request. People are making the request pretty similar to Mr. Yep. Brothers and sisters, we are very similar to Mr. Yep. We are this kind of people who always think that we know what is best, and we know what is best for our life. We know what is best for our family. We know what is best for our children. We know what is best for our church. We know what is best for the whole world, you know? And all of us want to rule the world. Brothers and sisters, this is us. We all like this Mr. Yep. This is who we are. But who is the Lord God that we see in the Bible? Who is the Lord God that we see Samuel serves? Who is the Lord God? Who is he? He tell the Israelite peoples to go home, to go back to your own hometown, to go there to wait and see. To see what? What is the Lord going to do to them? The Lord, he tell them to see his unsearchable wisdom, to see his unsearchable plan. He tell them to wait and see, to see his incomprehensible mercy and kindness towards those ungrateful and rebellious people who rejected him as their king. This Lord God tell people to wait and see. And what will the people see? The people of Israel, they will see a warrior king. King David is going to be given to the Israelites after King Saul, who is really, really bad and will do a lot of things that cause them to suffer. The Israelites people, they will see a warrior king, King David. And this King David that the Lord God gives is far better than anything the Israelites are expecting. It's far better than anything that the Israelites people could have dreamed of. Because they are dreamed of to have a king like the other nations, to have a king that can lead them so that they can be as strong as those other nations. But when God gave Israel King David led them to build a nation so great and so powerful that all other nations have to bow down to Israel. This is the Lord God, who is incomprehensible mercy and kindness. He gave people, those ungrateful people, a much, much greater king that they can expect of. And yet, this King David, he is still human. He is still demanding and he is still taking. He will and many, many of King David's will is just as sinful as the people of Israel. And the people of Israel will still have to pay for King David's mistakes. The country broke into multiple civil wars because King David sinned. And where is the hope? What would people see again? In God's time, people again, they will see another king, a Davidic king from the house of David. But this time is the king from the heaven. He is the heavenly king, our Lord Jesus Christ, God's only son, born into the house of David. This king, this final king that God gives to his people, is the most noble king. He is most noble. He is from the highest heaven and the only begotten son from the Lord God Most High. And yet this highest king, when he came to this world, he lowered himself. So much so that this highest king became the lowest of the servants. He even washed his disciples' feet, the things that not even the Israel servants will do. And this most high king, he's not taking at all. Instead, he gives and gives and gives. And he's continued to give. And he's even giving on the cross where he have nothing else. He have no clothes left on him while he was hanging on the cross. And yet he continues to give. He gives blessings. He gives forgiveness. And finally, he gave up himself, his body, and his soul. And yet people rejected him. Brothers and sisters, what do we want? What do you want? We see that the Israelite people, when they come to the moment of history, they think, the elders of Israel, they think what is the best for the nation is in their wisdom and in their discernment. And they make requests to the Lord God about what do they want. But brothers and sisters, as today, as someone who saved by our Lord Jesus Christ and decided to turn our life around to follow Jesus, what do you want as his disciples? What do you want as the follower of Jesus? Do you want this King Jesus more than anything and everything? Do you want him more than your fame, more than your success? Do you want him more than all your achievement and all the glories that the world can give you? Do you want this King Jesus more than the marks and the habits and the professions that you developed in the world? Do you want him more than yourself? Do you want him more than everything that makes you who you are? Do you want this King Jesus more than maybe a super pastor? More than an eloquent pastor? Do you want this King Jesus more than to have a great leader to lead our church? Do you want Jesus more than Billy Graham? Do you want Jesus more than to have maybe John Piper to lead our church? Do you want him more than an excellent LCEC chair or more than a perfect fellowship group chairperson to lead you? Do you want this King Jesus more than anything and everything for your church? brothers and sisters, I want to remind you that all pastors and leaders for the church, all of them are just servants, but only Jesus, He is the King of our church. Brothers and sisters, do you want this Jesus even more than your very life? Do you want Him more than your life? Many people have given their answer. The apostles have given their answer. They want Jesus more than their life. And the martyrs and many missionaries goes around the world, they want Jesus more than their every more than their very life. Do you want Him more than your life? So that when He returns, He can take everything and He can give you everything that He takes. Because everything on the day when He returns will be in Him. Do you want King Jesus more than everything? So before we close up today's sermon, let's read together on the screen with this word of prayer. Let's pray to our Lord Jesus. Dear Lord Jesus, come, I pray. Be the pastoral king for my church. Be the sovereign king for your people. Be my king and take my heart as your throne. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jacob, for your sermon today. We shall sing our hymn of response, Trust and Obey. Amen. Now we shall sing the doxology together. Let's wait for the music. Amen. All right, now is the time for church news and notices. Firstly, just want to welcome everyone once again, including anybody who just came in. Good to see everybody is able to log into Zoom. If you know of anybody that have any difficulty logging into Zoom, please help them. Or if you don't want to help them, maybe you can contact one of the pastoral team or even one of the technical people, Bernard or Clement, that they can help them to help log into Zoom, because depending on the lockdown situation, the restrictions, we might need to continue having service on Zoom. Okay. Welcome to Pastor Jacob. Thank you for joining us and for giving us the message today. Indeed, who do we want to be our king? We want Jesus to be our ultimate king. Going on to the bulletin. Does everybody have access to the bulletin, by the way? Maybe I'll see if I can try to share the bulletin with everyone. Okay, just give me 1 minute, okay? I'll share the bulletin on the chat box. Where's the bulletin? Okay, I'm sending the bulletin to everyone on the chat box in Zoom. Okay. It's got so many screens when you're using Zoom. Okay. And now church news and notices. Yes, because of the snap lockdown, we couldn't update the bulletin in time. So the bulletin is still having the regular worship leader, the song leader, Ching Yu and stuff. We couldn't change the bulletin in time. Announcements. So today's offerings, electronic offerings, will be collected, and a third of it will be sent to the District West as funding for district ministry. The fourth announcement is the EEU Conference, Australia Methodist Youth Conference, is organizing a training. It will be in July, 5th to the 9th of July, Monday to Friday. The conference fee is $100 and covers lunch and dinner. Hopefully we can still have it if the pandemic rages on in Perth, then I guess other arrangements will be made. Okay, registration ends on the 31st of May this next month. I have been to this conference before. It's really, really good. It helps people to have confidence to open God's word and to teach God's word to people as well. What is the main message? To learn what is the context of the Bible, to apply it adequately as well. To create Bible study materials and to read the Bible for yourself. Okay, EEU conference, great conference for youth and young adults. Car parking for Sunday services. Obviously, we can't park in church, so it's kind of irrelevant now. District Mission Conference. So there will be a mission sort of event organized by the district. It will be on the 15th of May. I think that's like 1 week before our church anniversary. Hopefully, again, the pandemic will subside and we can have these conferences. If not, I guess other arrangements will be made, and please stay tuned for information. Let me just share the slide. This district mission conference title is called Missions for All, Missions to All. It's on a Saturday, 15th of May, from 8:30 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. And the venue is Grace Methodist Church. Thank you, Jacob, for opening your church and for organizing this event. We have very special speakers. Yes, Jacob. We have very special speakers. Our very own Jonathan and Rebecca from Kingsway Methodist Church. We also have the leader of OMF, Dr. David Liao, as well as Greg Seymour and Sally Lee as well. They will be our speakers for this district mission conference. So you can, those of us who have been through mission teams before, or you are, you know, you are passionate for missions and would like to go to a mission trip one day, this will be a very good event. You get to talk to the missionaries, the long-term, the short-term missionaries, find out about their experience, and you get to meet with other members in the District West Methodist churches who are passionate and interested about missions as well. So it's a really, really good missions exposure. It does require a registration as well. Lunch is provided at $10. Please contact your local church mission stewards. In that case, you can also contact me or Reverend Sue or Pastor Ishii as well. We need registrations to cater for lunch, okay? So please take this. Those of you using computers, you can press the screenshot button and save it somewhere just in case you need this info, okay? Next announcement is pastors on leave. Pastor Ishii will be taking 1 week's annual leave from May the 4th to May the 9th, and she will come back. She says that she wants to go and read up on pregnancy and giving birth and stuff like that, so she knows how to do all that in the beginning of June, okay? Announcement number 8, IMC 25th anniversary. Once again, hopefully due to the pandemic, but all goes well, it will be on the 23rd of May, a Sunday at 10 a.m. at South Perth Community Centre. We need registrations as well, and registrations are done via the Tithely app. If you have any difficulty doing that, please ask someone to help you. And then we have a 25th anniversary Thanksgiving dinner as well on Saturday, the 22nd of May at Dragon Palace Northbridge. For students, 4 years old to full-time students is $40. Standard adult fee is $50. And for sponsorship ticket, the excess money will go to, I think, either it sponsors someone who cannot afford it or it goes to the church building fund, okay? So please contact your fellowship chairperson for purchase of the anniversary Thanksgiving tickets. And then number 9, the anniversary Count the Blessings origami star thing. I have attempted to make some stars. There you go. Stars. It's not perfect, but it's the best that my bulky fingers can do. We want to make these kind of stars, and hopefully we can make about, I think that the calculation was 2,600 stars to fill in a whole vase full of stars. There's been a change of plans. We don't need to have gold stars anymore. It can be multicolored stars, whatever color you like, it's fine. Our church has actually purchased a few thousand strips of paper, multicolored paper, for you to fold the origami stars. It's supposed to be available today in church, but you know, because of lockdown, we can't get it. So hopefully, if we are able to get to church next week, we can receive the stars, okay? If not, feel free to cut strips of paper and practice yourself. Watch YouTube videos on how to fold the origami stars. It's pretty simple once you get the hang of it. And the last announcement today is the Chinese Young Adult Fellowships change program once again. The Chinese Young Adult Fellowships are collecting those recyclable bottles, those 10 cents recycle bring to church, and they will recycle it. It's an ongoing program, and all the money will go into the church building fund. Okay. Yes, I think that's all for the announcements today. Can we invite Reverend Sue to bless us with the benediction?
Let us bow down our hearts and receive the Lord's benediction. May the grace of the Lord, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all from now on until eternity. Amen.
We'll now sing the Amen song. Let's wait for the music. Church has finished. Please have silent prayer and do spend your Sabbath today walking with the Lord. Thank you so much for well, coming on to Zoom on such short notice, and we appreciate for those of you who especially turned on the screen as well. God bless you. Hopefully, we are able to see you in person next week. If not, we'll see you once again on Zoom. See you.